Well, you went from having actual art, Flair and Anderson being something of a Picasso, to a different form of art, something more resembling giving a child a can of spray paint. We've got War Games up next. Team Hogan, the Hulkster himself, the Macho Man, Lex Luger, and the Stinger versus Vic's favorite stable faction of all time, the Dungeon of Doom. I would like to do a Dungeon of Doom episode at some point because, man, some of the garbage that came out of that, which is crazy because think of the talent that was in the Dungeon of Doom. As a whole, from start to finish, from its inception to when it was finally dissolved, think of the guys who actually were in the Dungeon of Doom. You know, Brutus Beefcake, Ed Leslie, whatever you want to call him, with 26 different gimmicks. At this point, he was the Zodiac. Earthquake, as we knew him in WWE, goes to WCW and becomes a shark. And he's going to bite all the Hulkamaniacs.
The shark?
He's not a shark, he is the shark. You're right. Yeah. Kamala, the Ugandan giant. We've got Ming, universally renowned as arguably the toughest guy who's ever been in the business. Kevin Sullivan.
I have the full list in front of me, and it's larger than I remember.
Well, I'm just, these are from the best of my recollection. Who else do we have? Who am I missing?
Here's the full list. The Master, the Taskmaster, Kamala, Lex Luger, the Yeti, Jimmy Hart, the Shark, Big Van Vader, the Zodiac, Ming, the Giant, Hugh Morris, the Barbarian, Conan, Max Muscle, Big Bubba, Braun the Leprechaun, One Man Gang, Z Gangsta, The Ultimate Solution, Loch Ness, and Jacqueline.
Jackie was in the Dungeon of Doom?
Apparently, 1997.
My goodness. But think of that. You listed off some really, truly heavy hitters, particularly like from my childhood. Think of the Hogan era, WWE, Hulkamania. Every enemy Hogan ever had in WWE basically came to WCW and formed the Dungeon of Doom. On paper, great idea. But my God, it was the hokiest thing of all time.
In 1995, though, you sat and you couldn't take your eyes off it. And let's not forget.
I disagree, Vic. I disagree.
Loved it.
Because even as a fan.
You did not. You were the one calling Sting on a fake hotline to talk to him. You didn't buy into the Dungeon of Doom.
That was several years prior. And yes, Sting.
Bull.
Sting not answering. Okay, so honestly, I think that on a human being level did something to me. When people go, I realized it was just entertainment, or, there was that moment, never meet your heroes. I didn't meet my hero. I listened to a recording of him that I paid money for, and that was when I went, maybe this isn't what I thought it was. And it really, really threw me for a loop, and I think I held a bit of a grudge against WCW as a whole for many moons, which also, and I keep referencing my dad, but this is what we did as I was growing up. My dad and I watched wrestling. That was what we bonded over. To this day, that's what we bond over and talk about is wrestling. So my dad had a lot of opinions that I think I absorbed by osmosis, like hating guys who didn't wear actual wrestling gear. And my dad loved the Big Boss Man. My dad loved Kamala, not in WCW, not in the Dungeon of Doom. So I just didn't have time for any of these guys. I liked Brutus the Barber Beefcake. Brutus was one of my guys. And now he's in WCW wearing zebra face paint going, yes, no, yes, no, yes, no, to the pleasure and delight of nobody.
The Dungeon of Doom was so bad it was cool, looking back on it.
No.
I'm a big fan of Dungeon of Doom.
Okay, so if we're going on a nostalgia hole, I would absolutely wear a Dungeon of Doom t-shirt today.
Yes.
Purely for the ironic value. It doesn't mean it's cool. It wasn't good. It's one of those things we look back upon fondly because it's funny to make fun of, and it's entertaining for all the wrong reasons, and it still has stood the test of time for none of the reasons intended.
It's also the era where we're still pretending like Big Show or Giant is Andre's son. Because after he runs over Hogan's motorcycle with a monster truck, they do an interview with Hogan and he says,
all of a sudden I felt this aura, this presence. I felt Andre, man, right in my face.
I mean, what about the monster truck on the roof? I mean, they had so much bad stuff, it was great looking back.
Well, Dan, that wasn't the only ludicrous statement to slip past the Hulkster's lips, particularly in this event. Alex, I believe you've provided me with the quote from one Hulk Hogan during the pre-match interview.
You can liken it to whatever you want, big dude. But right now, my war games, my teams are together, brother. And we just drank a couple gallons of Agent Orange, brother. So we're impervious to pain, man.
Here you have everybody's hero, the hero of a generation, basically Superman, saying, you know why we're going to win this fight, guys? We just drank Agent Orange, gallons of it, which, newsflash, Hulkster, that will kill you. That will kill
everyone.
Okay, he
said everyone. It makes you impervious to pain.
Do you know
Hogan
when it's really
immortal,
hard?
Hogan was immortal, Graves. The immortal Hulk Hogan.
Okay,
give me all the
fine.
Agent Orange, brother.
But you can't just go out there and say, hey, you know what? I'm ready for this battle. I drank Agent Orange because it makes me impervious to pain. Do you know why you don't feel pain, Hulk? Because you're dead. Okay, you cease to breathe and exist because Agent Orange will kill you. So, I don't know. It was a lot. It was ridiculous. And then Heenan later on would sort of double down on Hogan's ridiculousness when there was a fistful of mysterious powder thrown into the face of a competitor. Heenan declared,
"It smells like napalm or gunpowder."
I know we're really leaning into the military theme of this pay-per-view. Mm-hmm. Bobby might have been drinking a little bit of the same Agent Orange spiked Kool-Aid that the Hulkster was.
I loved the pre-match promo because it never seemed like it was going to end. Like, they walked off like it was over, and then all of a sudden Sting would run back in and have like two lines. Then Savage would run back in. It was like, it was just absolute chaos. And then I think Dan, you and I actually talked about this off air. Hogan gives away the finish in the promo.
Yeah.
Did anyone catch that? He goes, and if I win, I'm going to get 5 minutes with the Taskmaster. And then they come out to the ring announcer, breaking news. Michael Buffer goes, if Hulk Hogan's team wins, he's going to get 5 minutes alone with the Taskmaster. But Hogan just said it in the promo. Like, it was just so wild.
You knew what was happening.
Yeah, it was so wild. I was like, wait a minute. Hold on a second. Rewind.
Because I want 5 minutes with a
Hogan also uses a DTA, don't trust anybody, 1995. He says that in the promo.
DTA, what about the training footage?
Don't ever trust nobody. That was my favorite. Mm-hmm. When it,
right.
Lex Luger pulls out a rifle and is aiming it at things, and they're like, what the hell is going on? It was awesome.
They really leaned into it, and I admire the dedication. But some things, you know, this was the cartoon stuff. This is the sort of stuff that nowadays we look back upon as fun, as entertaining. It's nostalgia. But nowadays, it just doesn't work. It doesn't hold up. It does not feel important nowadays. It feels less than and hokey.
I mean, it felt hokey 2-3 years later. I mean, once we started moving towards DX and Austin and everything, like, they were done with the gimmicks like that.
And even the backstage interview with Mean Gene, and he goes,
pull up your socks and get ready.
What the hell are you talking about, pull up your socks? Like, it was so unbelievable. That was my absolute favorite part, was the pre-match promo before the main event. That's my biggest thing from Fall Brawl 95.
Like what you hear? Catch full episodes of After the Bell on Spotify. Follow us now and never miss an episode.